to the next topic. So, when we talk about bargaining theory, okay, again we will have a story. Suppose take an example of two cricketers like Sehwag and Rahul Dravid. Okay. So, Sehwag possesses a cell phone. Okay. Sehwag possesses a cell phone and he uses it, and somehow Rahul really had a kind of vision trespass. Okay. Vision trespass. He looked at the cell phone and he really valued that cell phone 50,000 rupees. Okay, 50,000 rupees. But that for Sehwag, the cost, the value of the cell phone to him, it's basically 30,000 rupees. Okay, so for Sehwag, the cell phone value 30,000 rupees. For Rahul, it is rupees 50,000 rupees. Yeah. Yes. If suppose Rahul approaches Sehwag, look, I will buy your cell phone. Is the transaction will generate cooperative surplus? Yeah. But once after the when he went to Sehwag and really look at the cell phone and see it, okay, then he really thought that okay, so I will pay 1 after he looked at the cell phone, he said it is worth to him 40,000 rupees. So, when he looked at it, okay, he valued it 50,000, but when he really would like to buy or the kind of thing, then he values it 40,000 rupees. When he values it to the 40,000 rupees. Then the price can be, okay, the selling price of that cell phone can be in between rupees 35,000 or rupees 40,000. This in between anything, or no, sorry, 30,000 and 40,000. Is it right? Okay, let us say if we fix the price, let us say 35,000. Let us say 35,000. So, if there is no bargain, if there is no cooperation between Sehwag and the Rahul Dravid, then the Sehwag will keep his cell phone and which is value to him 30,000, and the Rahul will keep his money 50,000 with him. Is it right? That is the no cooperation between the seller and the buyer. But if there is a cooperation, okay, then we have to see the threat values of the seller and the threat value for the buyer. Yeah, Sehwag is not going to sell his cell phone less than 30,000. Yeah, is it clear? That is his threat value. Okay, that is his threat value. So, what is threat value for Rahul? So, as we mentioned, if it is non-cooperation, then he will keep the cash, the Sehwag will keep the cell phone. But if there is a cooperation, then the transaction will generate the cooperative surplus. Yeah, how much it is. So, let us say in the case of cooperation, Sehwag receives 35,000. and the Rahul receives 35,000 worth of, no, 40,000 worth of cell phone. Yeah, 40,000 worth of cell phone. Then what else? Anything else? And rupees cash with him 15,000. Cash. Yeah. He pays 35,000. Then out of 40, he will have 5,000. Okay. Then initial price, initial value which he kept is 50, there the 10,000 rupees. So the 10 plus this 5, 15,000. Yeah, is it right? Yes or no? Yeah. So how much it is? Total? It is 90,000. This is cooperation. When they cooperate each other. What is the surplus? Okay, this is 90,000. But if there is no cooperation, then what is the value? Simple, 30,000 plus 50,000, no? 80,000. Okay, if this minus this, it is 10,000. If you want to have when this 10,000 is a cooperative surplus, then if you can divide that at equal basis, 5,000, 5,000. Yeah, 50%, 50%. Then all everybody will agree with it. Everybody will agree with it. Nobody will say, no, I am not going to cooperate with you. Yeah? So this is a simple thing. One can talk about bargaining theory. One can talk about bargaining theory. Yeah? Okay. So then we will move to the next one. What is the topic which we have mentioned? Okay, in this case, we have two parties. One is the landowner and other one is the community. Community is nothing but of the pre-existing households in that area, in that location. Yeah, pre-existing households. Yeah, and the landowner, he is the representative of the underdeveloped land for housing. Okay, when we talk about the landowner is a representative for underdeveloped land for housing. Is clear? So community means the community is the pre-existing household in that location. These are the two parties. These are the two parties. Now, the other point which we need to know is that more restriction, less restriction. Okay? More restriction. More restriction in the sense, if the entitlement, more restriction goes to community. And the entitlement less restriction goes to landowner. Is it right? So depends upon who is having initial entitlement. Who is having initial entitlement? Other party can bargain. Okay. When they bargain under rule of property rule and under the rule of liability rule. So please look at this graph carefully. When we move from left to right, okay, when we move from left to right, then it will be from less restricted regime to more restrictive regime. Yeah, and vice versa, and vice versa. Okay. So, when we talk about more restriction, okay, yeah, before come to that, we say the k, k prime, okay, k, k prime is the marginal benefit for the landowner, and the j, j prime is marginal benefit for community. Okay, community. So when we talk about the more restriction at point J prime, at this extreme point, even the landowner, he himself can't use land for himself. It is too much restriction. Okay. But then the individual have some kind of right, constitutional right. Okay. So, at least he can use his land for his personal consumption. He can construct a house for himself in his land. Okay. Then a little bit relaxation from this point to M.
So, but if at J prime you can't do anything,
yeah,
then what's the ownership?
Huh?
Then what is the ownership? If you can't be, then you own it. So you can just sell it. So you can do it.
No, you can't sell it, you can't use it also. Like I have a like in the case, it is a kind of high degree of state intervention, like production of opium. Okay, the farmers can't produce opium in their agricultural field on their own. The state has to give permission. Okay. And again, state will say how many acres you can use it, and whether you to whom to sell it, at what price you can sell it. At what price you can sell it? It is a high degree of state intervention. Yeah, if the state allows. Yeah. I think let us say like if there is a new airport construction, yeah, they declared the some radius land is a green zone. You have the ownership, but I think you can't really make any business out of it. Okay, whatever may be the safety reasons, whatever it is. Yeah, I think it is rarest of the rare case kind of thing. Okay, but for argument's sake, what we are saying is that at this point there is a more restriction, and the landowner he himself cannot do anything on his own at this point. But since there is some kind of individual rights given the constitution, at least he can construct his home at this point M. At this point M. Is it? Yeah. No, it is if I, no, in normal circumstances it is permissible. Okay. Suppose take an example, you allow that particular land for horticulture or something like that. Okay. When the businesses flourish, then there is a possibility of some economic activity. And a lot of mechanization, lot of people are working, and then trucks coming and going. Okay. If it is going to security threat to the airport, or it is also a safety problem. If suppose all of a sudden the aeroplane tire falls on someone who is working there, okay. There is a liability, okay, unilateral liability kind of. So, in order to avoid such kind of risk, then the state can, if it wish, okay, then it can say that it is a no movement zone. Yeah, it happens in the case of military areas. Yeah, like firing zones or something like that. There is a intensive military training activities areas across the nation. If there are such kind of intensive military training where they can use the real war situation kind of training, is it right? The neighborhood of that thing, you don't know which missile will hit what kind of thing. You declared that periphery to certain type of thing, even though you own the land, but you can't do anything with it. Yeah, it is a very few such examples. Not in normal sense, it is not really. But in rarest of the rare case, if we are lucky, then we will be in that situation. Okay. I'm coming to it. Which one? This one. Benefits. Yeah. Benefits. I'm coming to it. I'm coming to it. Okay. So what we are saying, the JJ prime is the JJ prime and KK prime are the marginal benefit curves for zoning restrictions to the community and to the landowner, respectively. Okay, that is the thing. This curve also behaves like a demand curve for the the right to use the land in a particular way. Right to use the land in a particular way. Then we see here the landowner's benefit. Okay. What we can say the landowner's benefit, suppose that is what I am saying, at J prime, the landowner gets no benefit from the land because he cannot use it at all. He cannot use it at all. Okay. But at point M, he can construct house for himself. He can construct house for himself. Is it right? Then the height of the KK prime, okay, the height of the KK prime will depends upon or determined by the demand for land for housing by outsiders. Demand for land, okay, for housing by outsiders. Okay. Then this also represent, it also depends upon how the community behaves in the case of less restriction or more risk. How the community behaves, whether it is a more restriction or less restriction. Yeah. Similarly, we can also talk about the community benefit. community benefit. So, what this community benefit, marginal benefit, that is j j prime, j j prime, what it says is that we can read that one from left to right. We can read it from the left to right. Here we need to talk about, or we need to know this, when we talk about the total benefit, when we talk about the total benefit to the present households who resides in that location, okay, it increases, it the benefit increases with additional restrictions on land use. Okay. I repeat, the total benefit to the present residents increases with additional restriction on land use at a diminishing rate, at a diminishing rate. Is it clear? Yeah. So, that means, when again this restriction in this restriction is on what? Vacant land. Again, this restriction is on vacant land. Okay. That means, what basically we want to say is that preventing land being used, preventing land being used for a high density housing, for a high density housing. Is it right? That means, the if you reduce the restriction, if you move from this point to this side, okay, it is a less and less restriction. Okay. In such case, what happens, before releasing of restriction, or when there is a more restriction, then in front of my house the land is vacant. Okay. The land is vacant, I can have a free view, okay, free view, and then I can have a fresh air and the natural sunlight. Suppose if there is a release in the, there is a relax in the restriction, okay, then the landowner can construct skyrocketing building next to my house. Okay. Not only it restricts the free view, but also the sunlight, but also the vision trespass. Okay. The person who sits in the apartment, they can see each and every activity what I am doing in my house, okay, if it is a open top kind of thing. Okay. So, hence whether the community would like to go for more restriction, or they prefer for less restriction on land use, on land use. Is it right? So, here what happens is that, suppose there are some households who are in the same location, they prefer less restriction. Why? If there is a more and more apartments, then there will be more and more children. There will be more and more children. It can have a social life. Okay. Some households, they like it. That is number one. Number two, when there are more and more households, they can share the taxes, property tax. It can be reduced, but the revenue to the local self government can increase. Is that right? But here there is a problem of nuisance. There may be some noise level is increasing, or pollution can increase. Okay. So, that means there are advantages and disadvantages when you are relaxing the, okay, moving from more restriction to less restriction. There the community is supposed to, some community favoring more restrictions, some community, the pre-existing community wish to have less restriction. There we talk about median voter decision. There we talk about median voter decision. That is one part of the thing. And Okay, let us come back to the discussion part. Suppose the entitlement is here, that is at point A, the property right, that A, this point, what it indicates, what is the entitlement here at point A? Is it more restriction or less restriction? Is it right? It is more restriction. If it is more restriction, who enjoys the entitlement? Who enjoys the land owner? If it is more restriction, if suppose I have the entitlement here at point A, what it means? The community enjoys it, because in front of my house, no, nothing. It is a I was yesterday with Professor Schaefer at Khajuraho. Okay, when we visited that, it is a very beautiful place with the greenery and nice architecture or scripts, whatever. When it is a big place, okay, with lot of trees and kind of thing, and across the road commercial development, okay, housing and commercial development. So when we discussed with Professor Schaefer how lucky these people are, okay, and having a house and coming out balcony and then really having very nice garden at the cost of the public. Is it right? The similarity is also true, like the Taj Mahal. Is it right? If you have a near to Taj Mahal, if and 24/7 you can enjoy with moonlight or whatever it is, kind of thing. Yeah. Suppose if some government attempts to have a commercial development adjacent to the Taj Mahal, then the beauty of the Taj Mahal will be at stake. Is it right? That is precisely what we wish to talk about: more restriction and less restriction. Is it right? Suppose if the community have the entitlement here, yeah, property right, more restriction, then if there is a cost theorem and zero transaction cost and voluntary bargaining is there, okay, voluntary bargaining is there, then how the land owner, okay, how the land owner will bribe the community, okay, under property rule and under liability rule. Do you have any answer for that by looking at this graph? So under property rule, how much bribe the land owner will offer to the community to convince them to relax the restrictions. To relax the restrictions, that means move from A to E. Yeah? Move from A to E. Is it correct? Yeah? So we are moving from this direction. So our discussion point here it is. Our discussion point here it is. Okay. So this is K. K prime is the marginal benefit curve for the land owner. Yeah? And the community has the entitlement here. Then the question here it is that under zero transaction cost, cooperative, the voluntary bargaining, okay, then the land owner would like to bribe the community to accept more restriction, to accept less restriction, to accept less restriction. Our question here it is, how much the land owner will bribe the community under property rule and how much the landowner will bribe the community under liability rule. This is what the question is. Do you have any answer for this? Is it clear? Question is clear? Yes? Then what is the answer? Yeah, so the graph is in front of you, then you tell me what area.
Will it be X?
Yeah. Under property rule, if suppose the landowner has to bribe the community for less restriction of the land use. Under property rule, then okay. So you mean to say the in the case of property rule, the whole area X plus W, the total. Why? No, the community is here. The community entitlement is here. If moving from A to E under property rule, that is true. I think we are simply saying it is W plus X. We are without making much complication and kind of thing, we by given the graph. Okay. We simply saying that under property rule, it is W plus X, under liability rule, it is only W. Is it clear from the graph? And same is true if the entitlement is here, A prime. Yeah. What do we mean by A prime? Means it is less restriction. Then the landowner can construct skyrocketing buildings, then the community will have some nuisances. Then the community will go to the landowner and request him to accept more restrictions. Is that right? When he goes for ask for more restriction, when the community goes and asks the landowner to accept more restrictions, that is from A prime to E, then the similar kind of thing under property rule Z plus Y, under liability rule Y. Is it clear? Yeah. Okay. So here, just you need to. I would like to say to you, just 2 points, and then we stop it. Okay, for your. What precisely we want to say here, it is in the case of the marginal benefit cost. Okay, the marginal benefit in the case of landowner's marginal benefit, this applies only to the landowner's marginal benefit. In this case, the landowner marginal benefit, that is K prime decreases, okay, as he moves from restrictive regime to the more restrictive regime of land use to the less restrictive land use. Okay. And in the case of marginal benefit for the community, in this case the marginal benefit, the marginal community benefit decreases as they move from less restrictive land use to the more restrictive land use. Okay. So, with this we reasonably can understand the basic information about this whole graph. Okay. So, it is simply rezoning of suburban locations, and the conflict is between the community and the landowner, and the community is pre-existing and landowner is a representative for the vacant land for housing. Okay. So, now what we would like to talk about is that if suppose between the parties, if there exist non-cash transaction, non-cash transaction. Have you heard about barter system? Yeah. And also even modern day subsidies kind of thing. Yeah. Subsidies, not in cash, but in something for something. Yeah. So, under such situation, if suppose the community has the entitlement, no cash transaction, either it is barter or subsidies, through subsidies, and community is having entitlement. Is that right? Community is having entitlement. Is it that leads to more restriction under property rule or less restriction? Is it question? I'm posing the question. Okay. So, there is no, it is a non-cash transaction and either it is a barter system or subsidies. The second one, the community holds the entitlement, initial entitlement, yeah, and will that leads under property rule or under liability rule, will leads to more restriction of land use or not? So, that is the question which we would like to answer it. There is some kind of if I give you 10 rupees, then you see it is 10 rupees. Okay. But if it is a barter system, the value is a subjective one. You can perceive high, you can perceive less to the real cost. That is the only difference. You want fan? It makes noise, it is problematic for me. Yeah. Is it okay? Yeah. So, if we look at this one, okay, as we have mentioned, is a more restriction, the initial entitlement is with the community. Yeah? Yes? Yeah? So, here the landowner has to bribe the community. Yeah? So, when the under property rule. Right now we are talking about property rule. Okay. Right now we are talking about property rule. Okay. So, in this case, if suppose landowner, when he pays when he has to pay 1 rupee to the community, then the community perceives it. Okay. It is 0.75 paise. It is a just perception. Okay. Landowner will pay 0.075%, but actual cost to the landowner is 1 rupee. Okay. So, once the community perceives it 0.075, then that k prime curve will reduce it to LK prime curve, because the perception of the community is 0.75 of 1 rupee. Okay, 0.75 of 1 rupee. So, at this entitlement, okay, so without that perception, it is supposed to be at E, but with the perception, instead of moving from A to E, they are just moving from A to E star. Okay, it is resulting in excessive restriction. Is it clear? That is what the question which we have raised it, and that is what the we are really talking about it. Okay. Suppose if we talk about the liability rule, okay. If we talk about the liability rule, is it right? And again, the initial entitlement with the community, the initial entitlement is with the community, then the landowner has to bribe the community. Yeah. And when the landowner pay the damages to the community, is it right? Suppose they pay, the landowner, in order to pay 1 rupee to the community, it costs him 1.25 paise, the damages, okay, like litigation costs or whatever it is. Is it right? So, in such case, that J J prime curve will shift to M M prime, M J prime thing. So, then instead of moving from A to E, yeah, they are simply moving from A to E prime or E1. So, it is again leading to more restriction. So, that means under non-cash transaction, if it is a barter system or subsidies, if the initial entitlement is with the community, okay, both under liability rule as well as property rule, it always leads to excessive restriction. In the case of liability, no, no, in earlier case we are saying it is less, it is 0.75 of 1. In this case, it is 1.25. Yeah. Yeah, in the case of damages, the cost to the landowner, it is 1.25 paise in order to compensate to the community worth of rupees 1 rupee. Okay, that is clear. Okay. But in the case of property rule thing, what we have said, could you just repeat please? No, what we have said, cost to the landowner. I think there is some correction there. The cost to the landowner is 0.75. Okay, and the perception to the community is 1 rupee. I think there is some change. Then I think that will clear your doubt. Is it clear? Yeah. So that means the landowner is it is less. Okay. Yeah, it makes sense. It is reducing from K K prime to L K prime, and in the case of damages, it is increasing, upward shift. Yeah, please correct it that the earlier which we have said, the cost to the landowner 0.75 and the community perceives it cost to the landowner 1 rupee in the case of property rule. Okay, please correct it if it is okay. Then there is one more, the other thing which we would like to talk about is that the same thing which we can also talk like. It is a kind of public decision, the rezoning, that means suburban zoning is a public decision. That means when you want to rezone the or when you go for the suburban development for housing supply, then the existing community has to take a decision. Is it right? Has to take a decision. That means the community have already the entitlement. Is it right? Then if we talk about property rights, then the landowner has to suppose to pay at the terms and conditions of the community, at the terms and conditions of the community. Is it right? In such case, okay, if it is a there is a kind of too much of terms and conditions, then it is better not to go for the rezoning.
But, so in sort of
that is in worst case.
But we don't see this layout in this fashion.
Maybe we will keep this question for the discussion. During the discussion, we can talk about it. Let me finish a few more things, then we will, during the discussion time, we will talk about it. Okay. Is it clear this one that? So, in the case of public decision, particularly in the transaction cost perspective, if the community has the initial entitlement under property rule, the landowner has to pay the bribe at the terms and conditions of the community. Is it clear? So, in such case, if there is a the community imposes more restriction, then it is better not to go for rezone. That's one kind of solution in a clear manner. Suppose if you even the small portion of the community can create problems when it is going to be rezoning. If some of the interest groups, they can go to the court, okay? If they can go to the court, they can stall the process of the rezoning, and when the landowner initiates the project, and that project won't complete within time, is it right? Then the cost of the project escalates, and at a given point of time, economically it is not feasible. What we are saying is that in a more clarity sense, in the case of public decision, particularly we are talking about transaction cost approach, if the community is having initial entitlement, okay, then the landowner has to bribe the community at the terms and conditions of the community under the property rule. Is it clear? If the terms and conditions are too weird, it is too much, okay, then it is better to go for not to go for rezoning. But if suppose it is going ahead, even a small portion of the interest group in the community can create problem by filing a case in the court, is it right, and delay the project, okay, and delay the project, and then the landowner has to incur the costs of damages, costs of litigation, as well as the costs of the delay of the project. At a given point of time, the project is not economically feasible. Yeah, so he has to wind up the project. This is precisely what this kind of thing explains. Okay, so when the landowner pays 1 rupee to the community, and the passiveness or actual cost to the landowner is 1.25. Okay, so it happens in real world situation. This kind of thing. Is it clear? Yeah. Or otherwise, you have to be careful while giving initial entitlements. either you give it to the community or you give it to the landowner. You have to have some kind of efficiency criteria. So, to whom you have to give in order to avoid wrong consequences. Okay, then we will talk about the other one is in this graph, the wealth effect. If we talk about the cost theorem, the cost theorem assumptions or the explicit assumption is no transaction cost, that is zero transaction cost. The implicit assumptions are so many. Within the implicit assumptions, at least two are no wealth effect and no strategic behavior, the implicit assumptions. But even under cost theorem, in this kind of cases, there will be wealth effect. There will be wealth effect. Okay. The wealth effect in the sense, if a community have the initial entitlement, then landowner has to pay. Is it right? If the landowner has the entitlement, then community has to pay. Is it right? So, who is having entitlement, the other party will lose some money. He has to pay, no? That much money is not available with him. He may gain, that is a different issue. Okay? But that much wealth will move from A to B or B to A, depends upon the given entitlement. I think we will talk about it. Okay? We will talk about it. Suppose the statement is as follows. The initial distribution of property rights does affect the wealth of the parties. Okay, that is the statement. Okay. The initial entitlements of the property rights does affect the wealth of the parties, whether it is true or not. Okay, whether it is true or not. So, we will try to understand that. Suppose at point A, okay, suppose at point A, yeah, or even point A prime, at point A or at point A prime, either it is the entitlement with the community or with the entitlement with the landowner. Okay, even under zero transaction costs, there will be wealth effect. There will be wealth effect. So why? The same thing what we have written, willingness to pay is less than the willingness to accept. Yeah, like gain is hypothetical, loss is concrete. Gain is hypothetical and loss is concrete. Is it right? Yeah. Okay. Suppose if we talk about J prime J. Okay. Suppose if we talk about J prime J, the demand for restrictiveness. The demand for restrictiveness, yeah, at point A, yeah, yes, under J prime, okay, the demand for restrictiveness is at point A entitlement. And then under L prime, the demand for restrictiveness is at point A prime. okay, at point A prime, is it right? Yeah. So, the lth effect is the distance between the J J prime and the L L prime. The wealth effect is the difference between the curves J J prime and L L prime. That is what we talked about, it is that. Okay. So, what we have said, the statement? No, what is in clarity? We gave one sentence statement. No? No. Are you getting it what we are talking about? No? What we are saying is that initial distribution of property rights, either to landowner or to community, okay, does affects the wealth of the parties. No, in the graph, if we say here is the entitlement given to the community, yeah, under the it is J J prime, yeah. And the entitlement given to the landowner under L L prime, yeah, and the difference between these two curves or the wealth effect between the parties when they bargain each other to be more restriction or less restriction imposed, whoever is having entitlements under property rule kind of thing. That is what we are saying. It is as simple as that. It is basically the when there is a more restriction, there is a kind of marginal benefit to the community. No, what? What precisely we want to say is that if suppose in the case of the entitlement, when parties need to bribe whoever is having entitlement, other is not having it, okay, in order to show the simple wealth effect when they transfer the money. It will have a some kind of wealth moving from one party to another party. Suppose take an example I can give you in a more clarity sense. Let us talk about the Coase theorem. Let us say there is a doctor and there is a confectioner. Let us talk about it. Okay. The confectioner, their neighborhood. The confectioner, when he uses his machines, then it really gives noise to the doctor, and the doctor is unable to diagnose the patients whether the heartbeat is from the machines or the stethoscope. Okay. So, hence he can't give proper diagnosis. Here the compensation, the negotiation amounts are like this, okay. Under zero noise pollution, the doctor will have 1,000 rupees, okay. Under noise pollution, the confectioner will have 2,000 rupees. Yeah. It is a confectioner, it is a doctor, yeah. Noise pollution, no noise, yeah. under no noise pollution, the doctor will gain 1000, okay, it is in rupees, let us say. Under pollution, this guy will gain 2000 rupees. Is it clear? Yeah. So, under no noise pollution, 0, under noise pollution, 0. Is it clear? No, is this is clear? We are talking about cost theorem only on zero transaction costs and voluntary bargain. And we are talking about wealth effect. I am giving this example only in order to understand the wealth effect. Okay, nothing more, nothing less. Yeah, I am not repeating the cost theorem again. That is not the purpose. Is it clear? If you are not understanding, please let me know. Suppose the options are installation of soundproof device, it is rupees 250. Yeah. And the confectioner moving out of his premises is rupees 2500. Yeah. And then to compensate to the doctor not to do any practice, enjoy the your life, and I will give you the rupees 1000 as a compensation. Or if we don't need to treat like that with a doctor, we will say, if suppose the doctor would like to move out of the move out of the premises, or maybe compensation, whatever it is, 1000 rupees, let us say. Suppose if the doctor has the injunction, okay, if the doctor has the injunction, then who has to pay? Confectioner has to pay. So which option is good? So the confectioner can pay 1000 rupees and ask the doctor to shut his, I think he can simply sit at his home and enjoy his life. Is it right? And confectioner moving out of the premises is too costly. Yeah, 2500 is more than the 2000. Then the cheapest one is 250. So he will go for this. Yeah. Yes or no? Then, if that is the case, how much is the confectioner value? Confectioner having money? Yeah. So if suppose the injunction is not with the doctor, but it is with the confectioner. No, if the court gives the right to pollute.
Which means doctor has no right.
Yeah, doctor not having right. That's what I am saying. That's what I am saying. Okay. It is possible, no? if I think the food is more important than the health. Yeah. So in such case, the confectioner gets the entitlement, injunction thing, so that against the doctor. So in such case, the doctor has to pay to the confectioner. No, I have a right. Otherwise, if the injunction is in favor of me and against the doctor, I will go to the doctor. Can't do anything. No, whether it may. Doctor is not causing harm, but the confectioner machines cause the harm.
Yes.
Yeah, so the problem is still there. I am not going to keep quiet. I run my machines 24/7.
Right.
Okay? and it will disturbs you, you can't practice it. If you want to practice, have a bargain with me. No, it is, I think there is no need of again raising questions in between, because you already know the cause theorem, how it works. Problem is a problem, whoever is having entitlement, but that problem need to be solved it at joint, what is that, least cost manner, or minimize the joint social costs. Is it clear? Yeah. Confectionery is having right. If suppose doctor would like to continue his business, then he has to bribe. Yeah. When he need to bribe the confectioner, what the options are available? So it is costly. It is ruled out. Okay. It won't make any sense losing or kind of thing. Then the cheapest one is 250. Yeah. I am not talking of, as I mentioned previously, I am not talking about the cause theorem, I am not repeating the cause theorem. I am just giving this cause theorem in order to understand the wealth effect. Is it right? If suppose the doctor has to pay to the confectioner, then how much money left to the doctor? Yeah. So even under cause theorem, okay. So whoever is having entitlement, okay, when other party pay to the thing in order to waive the right, then he lose some money. There is a wealth effect. So who will bear the cost of the installation of soundproof depends upon the entitlement. There is a wealth effect. There is a wealth effect. It is, he, if suppose he has to pay, yeah, then the confectioner will have 2000, then it is 750, 2750 total, yeah. So when this guy, when the other side is having it, it is, yeah. So even though the total surplus is the same, but when we talk about the entitlement allocation, then it does affect the wealth effect. It does have the wealth thing.
So in numerical terms, what would be the wealth effect?
Yeah, the 250 is the wealth effect. Whoever is having entitlement, and the other party has to bear it. This is precisely what we would like to talk here. Yeah? Okay. Then the same graph, we can also talk about legitimate, illegitimate reasons for zoning, for zoning purposes. Legitimate and illegitimate. Do you have any example for that?
Legitimate zoning
and illegitimate zoning, particularly illegitimate zoning. Is there any such thing happens? Have you come across any illegitimate zoning kind of thing? Pardon?
What would you mean when you say illegitimate zoning? What is it that you have?
Keeping the poor people away from the rich community under low income group housing. Yeah? and then even create the zoning based on the race. Yes? Yeah? Yes or no? Okay. So, here what we say is that this L prime is the legitimate motive based zoning creation, okay, and J prime is includes legitimate and illegitimate. The difference between these two causes are the illegitimate motive. Yeah, but illegitimate motive, whatever the definition, it is given by the courts and the legislatures. It is given by the courts and the legislatures. Yeah, even sometimes whenever you want to establish some polluted industries, okay, you give the land allocation where the poor stays, not where the rich having their houses. Is it right? Like if you want to create a industrial zoning, okay, which it is hazardous and heavy industries. So, instead of keeping at the neighborhood of the rich, then you always keep those things at the neighborhood of the poor. Yeah, the other reason also the property tax. Okay, inner city, the core city, the property values are high and the taxes are high, so that the poor can't pay that one. Then they move to suburbs. Okay, that is a different issue. But making the rezoning specifically for the purpose of segregation of the community, then that is not acceptable. If there is any such type of motives, that is what we call it as illegitimate motives. Yeah, and the last one which we would like to talk about is that monopoly control of land development. Monopoly control of land development. So, what it means, suppose take an example, the agency like Delhi Development Authority in Delhi. Okay. If we look at the DDA is having the supply of land for housing purposes at QC. Yeah. So, in order to reap the monopoly benefits, okay, they simply announce it land for the land available for housing purposes, not at the QC, but at the QM. Yeah, by declaring that, they will have the RM rent. Yeah, so that means A is the for the DDA. Is it clear? But the public is aware that the available land with the DDA is QC. Yeah. By knowing that, people they do. So if the QC minus QM, whatever the land it is available with DDA, then the buyers, they think that this land will also going to sold at any given point of time. Hence, they won't rush to purchase the land when the DDA announce it only QM not QC, they wait for it. That is point number one. In such case, the DDA can't reap the monopoly benefits. Then second one is that in such type of situation, number one, the DDA can announce it to the buyers that whatever the land it is QC minus QM, we are not going to sell it in future and it is not for sale. It is not for sale, but we will use this for a public park or some kind of development. So in such case, then they can have this monopoly rent. Or whoever the buyers already purchased the land from the DDA, then they can pressurize the DDA authorities not to announce this land for sale. Is it possible? That is how. So this is how the monopoly control of the land in a given city, how they behave. Either you talk about DDA in Delhi or Chennai Metropolitan Development and whoever. So with this, I stop it here.